So in this second part, I will continue telling you some other results that we got from other kind of structures. So this is basically an introduction based on what I already told you in the first part, phase resonances and superdirectivity, just a summary, and on-hand transmission. And then I will talk more about the dual period gratings, which is the same as compound gratings. Then two kind of all this part of the, my presentation will be dealing with transmission structures. In the first part, I show results on reflection structures. In this case, I will deal with transmission structures. So two basic kinds of structures I will be talking about. The first kind is slit metallic structures. And in this case, I will show you how do we solve the scattering problem, results and properties of these structures, and the experimental verification of the phenomenon that I will show. And the second kind of structures are structures formed by cylinders. In this case, we solve the problem by a different method, integral method, and also I will tell you about the scalar approach that is very simple and let us explain many of the features of the response of these complex structures in terms of very simple equations. I will show you results in two different situations. In the case where the wave is the incident wave is a propagating wave, and in the case in which the incident wave is an evanescent wave. So then I will conclude and summarize. So first, regarding what I already told you a couple of minutes ago about phase resonances and superdirectivity, that when we get a bunch of groups in a reflection structure, then we can get this kind of very, very sharp resonances, which are not only represent an intensification of the reflective field, but also they are accompanied by an intensification of the field inside the groups. And also, there is a particular phase distribution of the magnetic field within the groups, which is the responsible for these resonances. So in this case, we get what was called superdirectivity, because we get a very, very directive response only by increasing the number of groups in the structure, only by doing that. So we get, we can get very high quality resonances, and also this quality of the resonances can be increased as you like, only by increasing the number of groups. The particular phase distribution within the groups is responsible for the generation of these resonances. There is an intensification of the interior field. We get, as a result, superdirectivity in a passive structure, which is very difficult to find. And regarding the enhanced transmission, we can see here the same plot I showed you before, that we can have transmission peaks for certain wavelengths when you are dealing with structures like this, with holes in the resonant wavelengths. The transmission exceeds in several orders of magnitudes the intensity predicted by Bethe, that negligible intensity when you have subwavelength holes. more than double of the light incident on the host is transmitted, meaning that also through the host is transmitted the light that impinges on the plate, and several complex processes take place that give the result, as a result, the enhanced transmission, cavity molds, surface plasmons, and other kind of surface waves that are involved. So, to summarize, to get a broader idea of the types of resonances that we can find in infinitely periodic structures, it is important to have in mind all of them, because we are going to deal with this kind of structures. So the one of the well-known resonances are the Rayleigh anomalies, which are related to the appearance or disappearance of a diffracted order. You know that when a diffracted order appears, then there is like a sudden change in the intensity and in the response of this grating. So this produces anomalies that are called Rayleigh anomalies. Then we have surface plasmon excitations that take place only for TA polarization, the same case that we were studying before with the magnetic field along the grooves. Only in metallic gratings we get this phenomenon, especially for shallow corrugations. At least it was more investigated in the cases of shallow corrugation, because the surface plasmon resonances can be better predicted in this case. When you get these kind of excitations, then a significant power absorption takes place, and of course this resonance depends on the angle of incidence, on the period, and on the wavelength. So you need to have the right combination of parameters to get these resonances. There are other types of resonances that can take place in a diffraction grating. One is the surface shape resonances that are basically related with the geometry of each one of the cavities. These resonances are appear for both polarization. This is different from the previous one. For both polarizations, usually they are even stronger for TE than for TM. They strongly depend on the shape of the cavities. When these resonances are excited, there is an enhancement of the field inside the cavities. And these resonances are more important for almost closed cavities, meaning that when a very small aperture is left, then the modes inside these cavities are better excited. And finally, this new kind of resonances that I showed you in the previous lecture, that only take place for TM polarization and only in compound structures. This is very singular, this is very special for this kind of resonance. So the important message to take is that although you can get all the other types of resonances in all kinds of periodic gratings, these kinds of resonances, phase resonances, you can only get if you have a compound structure, meaning that you need to have several grooves or several cavities within one period. So, what are these dual period gratings? We already have an idea because of the previous lecture. But basically, this is a sketch of one of these structures. In this case, this is a transmitting structure. You remember that in the other case, we have grooves on a metallic plate, and in this case, these are slits. So, in this case, for example, the period is marked here, like D, so it starts from here up to here. So, within the period, we have three slits. this is the characteristic that makes possible to excite phase resonances. With this kind of configuration, with complex periods, we give the possibility of having opposite phases in adjacent groups. So here a more simple scheme in which we are in all cases drawing here only one period. I mean, in this kind of structure, this structure is repeated infinitely. It's a periodic structure where here we only plot one period. This is a one slit structure, which will be called a simple structure or regular structure. It's the usual type of periodic structure with only one slit per period. But then we have the compound structure with 2, 3, 4, 5 slits per period. So in our results, we keep the size of the period fixed and increase the number of slits within the period. We also keep fixed the thickness, the width, everything. Just we increase the number of slits. So in this part, we will focus on transmission structure, infinitely periodic, metallic wires, all this is metal, and sub-wavelength slits. So why it is interesting to investigate this kind of structures? Well, from one hand, this appear like new possibilities of designing structure for particular purposes. Because this kind of resonances only take place in this kind of structures. And of course, as these resonances affect significantly the reflected and the transmitted response, so if you can control the location and the quality of these resonances by choosing or adjusting the geometrical parameters of the structure. So this is like a new possibility of design of structures for particular purposes. So the basic idea of the model method that we use to solve this problem is schematized here. So we have an incident plane wave, TM polarized. So we express the field in this region as the sum of the incident wave plus the reflective field, which is also a sum of plane waves. And then the transmitted field is also expressed like a sum of plane waves. And within the slits, we expand the fields in terms of the eigenmodes of the slits. In this case, it's very easy because the eigenmodes are just sine cosine functions depending on the polarization, and so they are easily found and you can express the field in each one of these slits as a sum of the eigenmodes. One important thing to take into account here is that all these three slits are not equivalent, because they do not correspond to different periods. They are different cavities, and we have to express the fields in all of them because all of them are different. So basically we have the incident field, which is represented here by the incident plane wave plus the reflection wave. This ins means incident medium, not incident field. And here, in the transmitting media, you have also another sum of plane waves, as I told you before. And then inside the slits, you have this combination, which is basically a sum of the eigenmodes of the structures. One thing to notice here is that you can see that here are linear combinations of sine and cosine functions instead of only sine or only cosine as the waveguide modes of the slits. But this is because we are considering that the metal is a real metal. We are considering losses in the metal. We are not considering a perfect conductor, which is much easier to do. Okay. So then, when we have the expression for the fields in all the regions, the fields are matched at the horizontal interfaces by imposing the continuity of the tangential components in the open boundaries and requiring the corresponding boundary condition at each one of the open surfaces of the interfaces. And so when we do that, this leads to a system of coupled equations. We project the system and get a matrix system for the unknown reflected amplitude. So we have to invert a matrix and then we get the solution. So here are some of the results of the transmission structures that we investigated. So here you can see this J equal 1 means only one slit in the period, and this structure corresponds to this curve here. And you can see that this is the transmitted intensity as a function of the wavelength, normalized wavelength here. And you can see that if you have a regular periodic structure with only one slit per period, then we have peaks. And these peaks are related with the resonant frequencies or resonant wavelengths of the slit itself. So this is a very well-known result. When we add one more slit in the structure, we get pretty much the same, a little bit broader, the peak, but we don't get any new feature on the structure, on the response. But when we add one more and we have three slits in the structure, then we get the curve here that we see here. And you can see that inside each one of the peaks, there is a very, very, very thin dip within this peak. And this dip is related with the phase resonance excited in the structure. If we keep increasing the number of slits, 4 or 5, we get, in the case of 4, also one dip within each peak. But in the case of 5, we get 2 dips within each peak. And if we keep increasing the number of slits, then we keep having more and more of these dips. So why? Well, maybe we will talk about this later. Do you know why there is no dip here in the 2 slits case? Okay, let's see if in a couple of minutes you can answer this question. So here is the same results that I showed you before. To summarize what we see here, you can see that the peaks, I mean these features, correspond to waveguide mode resonance exists in each one of the slits. So for 3 or more slits, then a sharp dip appears that splits the peaks into 2. And for even more or equal to 5 slits, then one more dip appears. And these dips corresponds to a particular distribution of the phase of the field in each period, which is not allowed for simple gratings. This is very important. And this is the key for the response, for the answer to the question that I already For normal illumination, the possible phase configurations are symmetrical. What does it mean? If I illuminate the structure with a normally incident wave, let's see. If I illuminate the structure with a normally incident wave, then if I want to have opposite phases, then If I have only two slits, the only possibility is to have both of them the same face, right? Because if I get opposite faces, then I have no longer a symmetrical field. So this mode is not allowed. So if I keep illuminating with a normal incidence way, then even if I have two groups or two slits, I don't excite these phase resonances. Only when I get three, I have a possibility of having a symmetrical distribution of phases with the central slits with an opposite phase compared with the external ones. So this is related to what you asked before. So I will only be able to excite a phase resonance in this case if I illuminate the structure with an oblique incident way. So here are results of the near field for different resonances. Here is the what we call the first mode, and here the second mode, depending if it is this deep or this deep. And then you can see, in the case of three slits, that in the first mode, here, the faces are opposite, adjacent faces are opposite to each other, and there is a very high intensification of the field within the central one. And in the case of the second mode, you see that since the second mode represents the second resonance of the slit, then you can see that here it's like the space of the slit is divided in two parts, but anyway, in all along the slits, the faces are opposite to each other, and also the enhancement is found in the central part. So, in normal incidence, what or which possibilities we have of getting phase reversal, of getting opposite phases in adjacent slits? So for just one slit in the period, I don't have any possibility because all the periods are alike, so all of them have the same phase. Even for two, the only possibility I have is this one, because if I get opposite phases, then the field is no longer symmetric, as I told you, so this configuration is not allowed in the case of normal incidence. But as soon as I put three slits, then one possibility appears, which is responsible for the dip that I showed you in the curve in the previous slide. Then for four, the most I can have is something like this. So although these are opposite faces, in here these faces are the same, so the resonance in this case will be not as good quality as in the case of the three slits. And for five, then I get a bunch of possible configurations that combine opposite faces with equal faces. Of course, the best quality, the highest quality resonance will be this one, but these other modes are also present and also generate features in the transmitted response. So here is a study of the dependence of this resonance on the slit width. And you can see each curve corresponds to a different width of the slits, keeping the number of slits always the same in three. And so the width, you can see that the width of the peak, of the peak related with the waveguide mode, increases with the slit width. For example, here, this dark curve has the widest peaks. And also the dip shifts a little bit, but what we can see that it is not crucial to have exactly the parameter to have this resonance. The resonance shift, the peak is wider, but it's still there. So it is not critical to have a very, very accurate size. So this is these results correspond to oblique illumination and are probably answer to the question that you have. So these three curves correspond to 1, 2, and 3 slits per period in the normal incidence case. This is the same as I showed you before. And here you have the same structures, but under 30 degree illumination. And you can see that for the simple grating, there is almost the same response, but for the case of two slits, we have the dip here that was not present here. So this is because in this case, where the symmetry should not be kept anymore, because we illuminate with an oblique wave, then these opposite faces in the adjacent group, or groups or slits, can be generated, and then this is the responsible, these opposite faces are the responsible for this dip that appear here. And then, in the case of three groups, that we have only one dip, in this case we have two dips, because more configurations of faces are allowed. So, in this way, for oblique illumination, then we can get resonances even for only two slits per period. So this is the configuration that is responsible for the resonance. In the case of two, only allowed for oblique incidence, and in the case of three, that we only had under normal incidence, we only had plus minus plus, we have now two possibilities that generate the two dips that we have seen before. So, to investigate more on the dependence of these resonances on the angle of incidence, we made a band diagrams for each one of the structures. So the same, here is the simple structure, just one slit per period, and this is just the regular response that we get where no phase resonances appear. It's just the bright bands, meaning, so if we cut these band diagrams here, we get the curve that I showed you before. So making the cut here is the same as getting this result, right? So these two peaks that are here are these two bright regions here, okay? And here you can see how these are moved or are shifted when you increase the angle of incidence. So this is for just a simple grating, when we increase the number of slits, if we make the cut here, meaning we consider normal incidence, then we get a very similar response as here. But as we increase the number, the angle of incidence, we get this, you can see this like a dark bands within the bright ones. There is a dark line here and also here, and you can see in this case that how this dip evolves as the angle of incidence is increased. And of course, when we keep increasing the number of slits, then this band structure becomes more complex, and more bands, more dark bands appear here, and even here, even more complex. So, this kind of diagrams made us or remind the Venn diagrams of photonic crystals because they are quite similar, but in this case, with this kind of structures, we get exactly the opposite response of a photonic crystal. Because when you get a photonic crystal, you have forbidden bands, and then if you make a defect on a photonic crystal, you have a forbidden band, and within a forbidden band, we can have an allowed channel. In this case, it's exactly the opposite. You have an allowed channel, an allowed band, transmission band, which is all the bright part here, and the compound structure introduces these dark bands here, these features here. So it's like a forbidden narrow zone within an allowed zone. So it's like the photonic crystal counterpart. So after all this theoretical research, we confirmed all these results in collaboration with a group of Professor Mario Sorolla from Spain. They built samples. You can see here, this is one group, one slit per period. This is two slits per period, and this is three. Actually, these samples are like this size, and they made them very, very, in a very mechanical and not controlled way. But anyway, this was enough to demonstrate that these phase resonances are present in these structures. Here is more or less the summary of the results. These curves correspond to, you can see here, experimental and simulation results. And these two curves here, the flat ones, corresponds to the other polarization mode where you don't find any resonant feature, not in the one, not in the two, not in the three slits per period case. And in this case, you have the two peaks that I showed you in the theoretical results, but assume as you increase the number of slits, you can see that there is a dip appearing within each peak, which here is also more explicit. It is interesting to notice that in this case, although this experiment was done for normal incidence, but instead of a brain wave, it was a Gaussian beam. So in the case of a Gaussian beam, you have like parts of the beam are not impinging normally. So in this case, this caused this to appear, which confirmed that in the case of the oblique incidence, we get also the excitation of this resonance. And of course, in the case of three, it was clear that the dip was present. So up to here, regarding the structures made of rectangular slits, and now we turn to another kind of structures that we consider that are also compound or dual period structures, but made of cylinders. So in this case, we consider a structure like this with a bunch of cylinders in each period. You see that the separation here is larger than here. So the period is all of this long. In this case, in this scheme, we have five cylinders per period. And then a Gaussian beam illuminates the structure, and we will investigate their response. So besides of this possibility of exciting the phase resonances, this kind of dual period structures have other properties that are very interesting to tailor the response. For example, one possibility is to suppress to cancel a particular diffraction order. For example, here you have two curves. The black curve corresponds to a compound array, and the dotted one corresponds to the simple array. So you can see that in this case, although for the simple array, all the directions, all the efficiencies are more or less the same, in the compound array, in this case, the parameters were chosen in such a way as to cancel, for example, this and this diffraction orders. And this was done for, in this case, for both polarizations. You can see here that this is the effect in the reflection. The upper curves correspond to the reflections, and these ones to the transmission. And in both cases, even for the reflection and even for the transmission, we get this suppression of a particular diffraction order. So we can design the structure to cancel out a particular diffraction order. So at the same time, if we cancel one, then another one will be enhanced. So in this case, this plus and minus two orders, diffraction orders, are minimized. So there are another there is another property very interesting, that is an intensification of a particular diffraction order. So in this case, you see the simple array, which is the dotted line, has all the orders more or less the same level. But here it was the parameters were chosen so as to enhance the plus minus three, this and this one. So you can see that for both polarization, we get pretty much this effect, and even for reflection and even for transmission. So this dual period arrays, you can see that have many potential possibilities for design. So we wanted to go further a little bit and to investigate if this property of suppression or intensification is still present when we change the angle of incidence. So here we plot the intensity as a contour plot, grayscale, and here you have the observation angle and here the incidence angle. And you can see all these curves correspond to silver cylinders, and all these ones to silica cylinders, meaning that you have metallic or dielectric cylinders. So completely different materials. And then for the cases here, these four plots correspond to regular structures, meaning only one cylinder per period. And here, the parameters were chosen to block or to cancel all the even diffraction orders. And you can see that for all the incidence angles, this result was achieved, more or less, even for silica, even for silver, for everything. So it is a very geometrical effect. So to go a little bit farther, we make the structure a little bit more complex, and then we consider to take out the each of these chains of cylinder, to take them out from the periodicity direction. So we investigated the structure like this, which is a finite array of cylinders, which can be metallic or dielectric. The cylinders are distributed in a finitely periodic array formed by subarrays. So each one of these, we call them subarray or chain. And we have in the structure a finite number of those. We consider a Gaussian beam incidence, both polarization modes, and the whole system is immersed in air. So to solve this problem, we no longer use the modal method, but the integral method, which is more useful in the case of complex geometries. So this is the method that we implemented, especially for this dual period structure. And this method is very convenient because it allows us to investigate more complex profiles of the structure. So this is the basic equations. I will not go in the details of this, but the basic idea of the method is that you can find the fields everywhere in space if you know the fields on the boundaries, on all the boundaries that are present in your structure. So the first step of this method is to find the fields in the boundary, and then when you have them already, you can find the field everywhere, including the reflection and transmission amplitudes and everything. So this is summary. Of course, more details are in the publications. If someone is interested, I can tell more later. This is important, we use asymptotic expressions of the Hankel functions to express the fields in the far field, and this enables us to find the far field amplitudes, reflected and transmitted. So, this is the complex method, this is the rigorous method, and of course we implemented it and we got our results. But to get more physical insight in the results, we developed a scalar approach. A scalar approach is a very, very simple approach that gives us the possibility of understanding better what is going on in the structure, enables us to interpret the results more easily. So the basis of this scalar approach is this expression. Basically, in the first course on optics at university, you learn about the diffraction grating, and then you know that there are several factors that contribute to the response. Usually you have two factors, not three, like here. So one is more related to the diffraction of one single object, and the other one is related to the interference between many objects. In this case we have three, because we have, from one hand, the interference between one period with the other. Then we have the diffraction from a single object, but we also have here the interference between the objects in the same subarray. So three terms or three factors are present here. So each factor is related with a different feature of the response. So this one with M is related with the interference in each one of these subarrays. The second one is related with the interference of the cylinder. Sorry, this second one is related with the interference within here, and the first one is the interference between different periods. And then finally, this one is related to the diffraction of each one of the cylinders. So in this expression, you can see this alpha, beta, gamma are here, and in gamma we have this angle phi, which is the inclination angle of the subarray. So it seems that by changing this angle, one will be able to change the response. So basically these two factors govern the response, because this one is just a very big, very wide, in this case, a very wide response because of the size of the cylinders is very, very small. So remember that these two factors are related with interference phenomena. So this factor gives the interference between different periods gives us the directions of the diffraction orders. This is well known, and this is the equation of the, it is known, the grating equation. But this one, the middle one, is the one that is really new. This factor is the one that is the main part of this expression, because it's the one that we can play with to tailor the response. So in this, exactly this parameter gamma, we have the phi, the angle, the inclination angle, and other parameters that can give us a possibility to enhance or suppress or do what we want with the diffraction order. So here, for example, you can see the different, we plot here the different factors separately. So the blue one gives just the directions of the diffraction orders, all of them of the same intensity. But the red one, the factor that is appears here in these dual period structures, modulates this response, and is, in this example, was chosen in such a way that only these diffraction orders stays there, and the other ones are almost cancelled, and this is the result, the resulting response. So you can see that by choosing these parameters, we can choose or design the response, even when considering only this scalar approach that is very, very far from the real structure. So here are the results obtained with the rigorous method, the integral method that I told you before, where we plot the reflection coefficient as a function here of the inclination angle and here of the observation angle. So each one of these vertical fringes corresponds to the diffraction orders. That, of course, these directions do not depend on this angle, because the period is always the same in all the structures. But you can see that there are certain values of the inclination angles that are enhanced here, here, and even for silica cylinders. Also, you can find certain resonant values. So even though you have in all cases all the direction of the directions of the diffraction orders in the same place, in the same directions, you can enhance the intensification or the intensity in a given direction for with a particular angle, inclination angle phi. And you can do that even for silver cylinders or for silica cylinders. In this slide, I just show you that, of course, the response is different when you change the radius of the cylinders. But anyway, if you only change the radius but keep the resonant conditions, you get higher or lower peaks, but the effect is still present. Here are results for transmission coefficient, where you can see more or less the same behavior, that although the directions of the diffraction orders are always the same for all the inclination angles, there are certain values that are resonant, that are better for the intensification of such an order. So we can intensify even the reflection response or even the transmission response in a particular direction. And this is just the near field, how it looks like near a resonance. And you can see that these two plots correspond to S-polarization, meaning the electric field along the cylinders. And you can see that, I don't know if you can see here the lines of cylinders that are drawn here, but here the intensification is like between these chains. So the chains, one after the other, behave more or less like a cavity. Like in the middle of two chains, a cavity is formed, and in these conditions, the S-polarized electromagnetic field resonates. On the other hand, in the case of P-polarization, the resonance is somehow different, and you can see the intensification is along the chain of cylinders. So the intensification is more related to coupling of cylinders, of the field of the cylinder. So up to now, we consider a system that we illuminated with a propagating wave. In this case, we also investigated what happens with this kind of structures when we illuminated it with an evanescent wave. Meaning that if we don't put anything, we just, how we do that? I mean, there is an incident wave that is impinging on coming from a medium that has a higher dielectric permittivity than this medium where the cylinders are immersed. So if you do that and you have your incidence angle is larger than the critical angle, then you have total reflection, total internal reflection. So this means that there will be no propagating wave going to the other side, right? So if we don't have any cylinders here, just the interface between these two media, and we come with this angle here, then all the light will be reflected. No transmitted light will be available there. So we try to see if we put very close to the interface these chains of cylinders, if we can somehow send part of the power, of the intensity, of the energy to the other side. So this was a motivation of this part of the research that we did. So we investigated just a single chain, a structure formed just by a single chain, and also a compound system like those that I showed before. So for a single chain, we have here the curves that for S-polarization we don't get any interesting result, just an increasing curve. But here we get some peaks telling us that maybe we can do something with this. We have like resonant wavelengths. So if we look closer at the near field of the chain, we can see that there is like a coupling, like an intensification between the cylinders, and also here, you see that these curves correspond to different inclination angles. Here is 30 degrees, so this angle is 30 degrees, and here is 45. So you can see that part of the field is on the other side, and the challenge then was, will we be able to send this field that already is on the other side as a propagating wave, like a transmitted propagating wave? And if we can do that, will we be able to send this energy to the direction we desire? So we made some calculations, and here are the results. This is for a single chain, similar to what I showed before, that in the case of P-polarization, we get like a peak, and the peak is found when we have a near field intensification. And in this case, with the same parameters, we build a compound system And in this case, what is plot here is the observation, the intensity, the transmitted intensity as a function of the observation angle and the wavelength. These black lines here correspond to the diffraction orders. You can see -1, -2, -3, -4. So these directions are predicted by the periodicity of the structure. But all these red or green or red regions represent intensity that goes to the other side and goes with a particular direction. So here, this in this system was the parameters were chosen to have intensification here for 30 degrees, and in this case, it was chosen to have here for -30 degrees. So you can see that with this compound structures, we can not only take the evanescent wave up with the chains, but also with this dual periodicity, we can decide in which direction we are sending this intensity. So to summarize this part, I would say that this dual period structure exhibits anomalies or resonances that are not present in single period or regular gratings. These phase resonances arise from a particular distribution of the phase, as I already told you, and amplitude of the magnetic field inside the slit. They appear as sharp dips in the transmitted response. For the resonant wavelength, the field is strongly intensified within the slits, and the resonant wavelength and the quality of the resonance can be controlled by changing appropriately the parameters. And regarding this cylinder structure, regarding the propagating wave incidence, we can get an intensification in a given direction that we pre-designed. It is purely a geometrical effect, so we can get it even if the cylinders are metallic or dielectric. It is like a Blaze effect, you know, the like a Blaze gratings that you can choose the direction of the transmission of the efficiency, choosing the angle of the grating. In this case, you can do it for reflection, for transmission, for different materials, for both polarization. And of course, this is scalable to other regions of the spectrum. We did all the calculations for the visible range, but this is not a condition. In the case of an evanescent wave, then we have like an optical antenna, because we are converting the evanescent wave to propagating waves that go to the other side. In this case, we need to have metallic cylinders. This effect is found at certain resonant wavelengths. And at those wavelengths, this antenna radiates to the far field. And as I already said, the direction of maximum transmittance is governed by the period of the structure and by the inclination angle. So there is a lot to do. We can consider two-dimensional dual period structures, different geometries of the cavities. We can work on particular designs for particular purposes. One thing that we also want to do is to better analyze the complexity of the response, because for larger cylinders and for large inclination angles, there are many, many processes taking place at the same time, so it is somehow difficult to understand everything that is going on there. And also we are going to consider dielectric cylinders under evanescent illumination. So that's all.